Black lives matter, and our children definitely matter. When writing about black children, I couldn't help but think of the opening words to The Greatest Love of All, written by Linda Creed and made popular by the magnificent and unforgettable voice of Whitney Houston. I believe the children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside. Give them a sense of pride to make it easier. Let the children's laughter remind us how we used to be. Everybody's searching for a hero. People need someone to look up to. I never found anyone to fulfill my needs. A lonely place to be. And so I learned to depend on me.
Let's stop and think. Are we fulfilling the needs of our children? Are they in a lonely place? Are we leaving our children to depend on themselves? Can our children find a hero to follow? Of course, we have heroes and many positive role models, but are our children being exposed to them? Are these heroes included in the school curriculum? Are parents even aware of these amazing African-American people that our sons and daughters need to be looking up to? Too often, this nation's society leaves our youth feeling alone and in a very lonely place.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a
A brown mother's prayer. My sweet baby, with eyes so big, filled with wonder, searching the world. My sweet baby, with eyes so tender, filled with joy, hoping to see, hoping to feel, hoping to learn. What will be? Do the faces that reflect back smile? Do they love? Do they touch your soft, gentle heart? Does mother's caress tingle your warm brown skin? The skin that Almighty God shaped you in? Will the world see God's work? Will they know it was Him who shaped your life and your chocolate brown skin? Will they know that I have kissed your face and blessed the Lord for His blessed grace? Do they know the mercy I wish for you as you enter the world so innocent and new? It is my prayer that we hold you near. It is my prayer because you are so dear. It is my prayer that faith conquers my fear. Wrapped in a broken heart that looks out there, that looks at the world, shaking my head and knowing
many of us today recall the time when black lives were invisible in the world. Let's go back and remember.
Mother reads the stories that lull me fast to sleep. I see the pretty pictures, but I wonder, where am I?
The mail is here. The cards have come. My name is on a few of them. But I wonder, where am I?
I see the dolls under the tree, the toys and games, but I don't see me. And I wonder, where am I?
The family programs made for kids, they're on TV. But something's missing. I don't see me. So I wonder, where am I?
The popcorn, the candy, the soda machine. We watch the long movie. I look at all the actors. Who I don't see is me. Again, I wonder, where am I?
This is church with God and Christ. I look hard to see. Does He look like Daddy? Does He look like me? He doesn't. So I wonder and ask Him, where am I? The teacher says it's time to read. It's Dick and Jane. Look, Jane, look. I look, but cannot see anyone who looks like me. I wonder, where am I? The teacher says it's time to draw flesh colors in the box. When they planned the colors, it's me that they forgot. I wonder, where am I?
The teacher says it's story time. She holds up picture books. The pictures are quite clear to see. Nobody, but nobody, looks like me. Again, I wonder, where am I? Then there are the holidays. We celebrate happily. I look at all the heroes. Do they look like me? I wonder, where am I?
Yay, it's museum trip day. Mona Lisa, we came to see. But I'm looking for a painting, one that looks like me. I wonder, where am I? Finally, I find something that sort of looks like me. Black bodies that are running. Could this possibly be? But the teacher's head is shaking. No smile upon her face. Can't I find someone like me? Aren't we any place? So I wonder, where am I? Where am I?
Where are the black people? Didn't we do anything worth writing about or celebrating? My story matters. My life matters.
Look carefully at this slide and think about what you see. There is a hunter and there is a lion. What story will be told? Hear this African proverb and remember, until the lion tells his own side of the story, the tale of the hunt will always glorify the hunter. Who is telling the American story? Who has written world history? Who does this history glorify? How does this story frame the perception, the thinking, and the self-esteem of everyone? We came on the Mayflower. How did you get here? Who do you think perceives themselves as superior and who inferior? Who believes themselves to be unworthy? Who experiences entitlement? How are people emotionally and even physically impacted? What effect does this have on our children?
I love to smile, laugh, and have fun. I enjoy people, all people. That is obvious to anyone who meets or knows me. However, even before the coronavirus, I have been wearing a mask. It is the survival mask that so many people of color wear. It covers the hurts and indignities that are suffered by a history of physical, social, and emotional abuse. Paul Laurence Dunbar captured those feelings in his poem, "We Wear the Mask."
We wear the mask that grins and lies. It hides our cheeks and shades our eyes. This debt we pay to human guile with torn and bleeding hearts. We smile and mouth with myriad subtleties. Why should the world be overwise in counting all our tears and sighs? Nay, let them only see us while we wear the mask. We smile But oh, great Christ, our cries to thee from tortured souls arise. We sing, but oh, the clay is vile beneath our feet and long the mile. But let the world dream otherwise. We wear the mask.
Let's talk about American history. What parts of the story have been omitted? What are some of the truths that this country holds so dear and honors so highly that we have established holidays around them and erected statues? How many of these truths have actually been altered, even falsified?
In a CNN article on July 24th, 2020, Republican Senator Tom Cotton of Arkansas has introduced legislation that takes aim at the teaching of the 1619 Project, an initiative from the New York Times that reframes American history around the date of August 1619, when the first slave ship arrived on America's shores. A statement from the senator's office announcing the bill introduction states that the legislation will be titled the Saving American History Act of 2020 and would prohibit the use of federal funds to teach the 1619 Project by K-12 schools or school districts. Schools that teach the 1619 Project would also be ineligible for federal professional development grants. Here is some interesting double talk. America was not built on slavery. Then he turns around and says, quote, as the founding fathers said, slavery is a necessary evil upon which the Union was built. What kind of Tom Cotton picking double talk is that? My brain is screaming what in all capital letters. President Trump tweeted this on Sunday, September 1st, 2020. California has implemented the 1619 Project into the public schools. Soon, you won't recognize America. Department of Education is looking at this. If so, they will not be funded. America, and especially this president, wants to ignore, even refute its ugly past to preserve a precious image that lifts up one group of people.
When I was a child, there was only 1 week in the entire year that teachers could direct their attention to Negro history. The teacher crammed as much information as she could into that time span. The godfather of Black History Month and the author of The Miseducation of the Negro is Carter G. Woodson. The son of slaves, Woodson was highly educated. He received his PhD from Harvard University in 1912. Woodson was particularly concerned with recording Black history and culture. He felt that a culture or ethnic group with no record or ancestral memory is a group without roots, easily tossed about in the waves of history. In 1926, his efforts led him to co-create with influential Black minister Jesse E. Moreland an annual observance of Negro History Week. It was set in the middle of February, the month in which Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass were born. In 1976, President Gerald Ford officially recognized Black History Month. He entreated the American people to seize the opportunity to honor the two often neglected accomplishments of Black Americans in every area of endeavor throughout our history. Since then, every American president has recognized February as Black History Month. Intelligent people know that Black history is American history.
I am the king of the jungle, the leader of my pride. It is important for me to understand as king that there is a delicate balance that must be maintained in order for harmony to exist. There has been an interruption in that balance, and now we have scars. Let them be reminders that there are those who have tried to break us. The pride has suffered great losses. However, we are not defeated. There are those in the pride who rise up as they take their rightful places. Their stories must be told. Let those stories be heard. Teach the children who they are, or white supremacy will.
As the world searches for a vaccine to conquer a pandemic that ravages the earth, let's keep this story in mind. Onesimus, an African slave, was a gift to the Puritan church minister Cotton Mather from his congregation in 1706. Onesimus told Mather about the centuries-old tradition of inoculation practiced in Africa. By extracting the material from an infected person and scratching it into the skin of an uninfected person, you could deliberately introduce smallpox to the healthy individual, making them immune. Onesimus's traditional African practice was used to inoculate American soldiers during the Revolutionary War and introduce the concept of inoculation to the United States. By the way, COVID-19 has us needing this concept of inoculation today. Born a free man in 1807, Henry Blair was the second African American to be issued a United States patent. Despite being illiterate and uneducated, he was a successful farmer who patented two inventions, a corn planter and a cotton planter. Both of his inventions greatly increased efficiency on the farm by limiting labor and time.
Now, we're going to mosey out west to check out some cowboys. Black cowboys. Cowboys played an important role in the settling of the West. Ranching was a big industry, and cowboys helped to run the ranches. They herded cattle, repaired fences and buildings, and took care of the horses. Probably no one realizes this, but 1 in 4 cowboys was Black, despite the stories told in popular books and movies. In fact, it's believed that the real Lone Ranger was inspired by an African-American man named Bass Reeves, who was born in 1838. Reeves was a master of disguise, an expert marksman, and had a Native American companion and rode a silver horse. The movie Glory, starring Denzel Washington and Morgan Freeman, shed light on the underappreciated heroes who were known as the 54th Massachusetts Infantry Regiment of the first black company fighting in the American Civil War. These soldiers were forced to deal with the prejudice of both the enemy, who had orders to kill commanding officers of blacks, and of their own fellow officers. Black veterans remain disenfranchised and underappreciated even today. Yet, these faithful black men fought with pride, valor, honor, and march to glory.
We're gonna let Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell sing the intro to this story. Elijah McCoy, born in 1844, was an African-American inventor who received more than 50 patents for his inventions during his lifetime. His most famous invention was a cup that fed lubricating oil to machine bearings through a small tube. Many of you have heard the line, "I want the real McCoy." In other words, we don't want a fake cheap brand. We want the real McCoy. So back to Marvin and Tammy.
Let the music from the Spirit of Alaska album, along with the mournful cries of the whales, usher us into this northern adventure story. Matthew Henson is special to me because in elementary school, during that 1 week of Negro history, he was my assignment. Henson was an accomplished explorer who, along with Robert Perry, was one of the first men to reach the North Pole. Though both men were valiant and gifted explorers, there has been much controversy surrounding the discovery of the North Pole and who, in fact, reached first. Sadly, this controversy is said to be due in great part to racism at that time in America and the fact that despite providing skills invaluable to the 1909 expedition, Henson was technically considered an employee of Perry, someone who helped Perry reach his Arctic destination. However, it was said that Henson placed the flag before Perry arrived. While his achievements were celebrated in the black community, Henson received no national public recognition for his contributions to the expeditions for several decades. This, despite Perry having said of Henson during their last and final victorious North Pole expedition, quote, "Henson must go with me. I cannot make it without him," end quote. In fact, though Perry received the prestigious National Geographic Hubbard Medal from President Theodore Roosevelt following their 1909 expedition, it was not until the year 2000, over a decade after Henson's death, that he too was awarded the recognition. National Geographic, which awards this highest honor, celebrating distinction in exploration, discovery, and research, publicly admitted that the award was long overdue. Keeping with the frozen cold theme, we look at Frederick McKinley Jones, who received a patent for creating one of the most important inventions to modern agriculture, the refrigerated truck, in 1940.
Duke Ellington's sophisticated ladies, sophisticated black ladies. Yes, that's where we're heading. Bessie Coleman was an early American civil aviator. She was the first African-American / Native American woman to hold a pilot license. Miss Bessie earned her pilot license from the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale in Switzerland on June 15, 1921. She was the first black person, period, to earn an international pilot's license, which she acquired in just 7 months. She taught herself French, parlez-vous français, and moved to France. She took her first flight in 1922. Oh, I told you we would be talking about sophisticated ladies. Let's look at this Betty Boop story. Helen Kane would be the lovely lady at the top to the left. Many of us know her signature song, "I Want to Be Loved by You," which she recorded in 1928. It was a favorite of Marilyn Monroe and Ginger of Gilligan's Island. 2 years after Helen sang this song, the Betty Boop character was created. When her career began to slip, she filed a $250,000 lawsuit against Paramount and Max Fleischer for wrongful appropriation of her in Betty Boop cartoons. They probably said it takes one to know one. She lost the case because it was found that she was appropriating baby Esther Jones, who Helen viewed in a Harlem Cotton Club show. Kane said she came up with the boop-boopy-doop thing. However, this was part of jazz scatting. Esther Jones was declared the original Betty Boop inspiration. Unfortunately, she received nothing. The movie Hidden Figures told the story of three incredible sophisticated ladies known as the human computers. Mathematician Mary Winston Jackson excelled academically in a time of racial segregation. Her math and science skills earned her a position as a human computer for the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, or NACA, and she later became NASA's first black female engineer. One of NASA's human computers, Katherine Johnson, performed the complex calculations that enabled humans to successfully achieve spaceflight. Dorothy Vaughan worked as a mathematician on the Scout Launch Vehicle program that sent America's first satellites into space.
We've been moving along the timeline from Onesimus in 1706 to the NASA scientists of the 1950s. But we're going to go back to 1864 to focus on the amazing life of a baby boy who was born a slave. He was kidnapped along with his mother. She was found dead, and the baby was near death. The slave owner and his wife raised this baby and his brother. The child grew up to be George Washington Carver. George Washington Carver was one of our greatest scientists, and he often prayed, addressing God as Mr. Creator. When asked, "Where did you learn all this? What book?" Carver's answer was quite clear: the Bible. In Genesis, we are told, "Behold, I have given you every herb that bears seed on the face of the earth, and every tree bearing seed. To you it shall be meat." Carver said, "Without God, I am nothing." Many prominent people sought Carver's advice and enjoyed his company. Thomas Edison once invited him to come to work with him in the Edison Laboratories in Menlo Park, New Jersey, at a minimum salary of $100,000. Carver declined the offer, as he had all the others, and seemed astonished that anyone expected him to claim rewards from the gifts God had given him. "But if you had all that money," Edison challenged, "you could help your people." Carver responded, "If I had all that money, I might forget about my people." Carver helped Henry Ford use plant weed for producing synthetic rubber. He also managed to develop a plastic material from soybeans, which Ford was able to make use of in certain parts of his automobile. At one time, Carver wanted to be an artist, but could not make a living from it. His teacher felt that he was a brilliant scientist and encouraged him to go to an agricultural school. Carver performed in piano concerts to raise money for Tuskegee. He also played the accordion and mouth harp. In the early 1900s, Carver developed a crop rotation method which revolutionized Southern agriculture. Carver created over 300 peanut products, and he made glue and medicine from peanuts and sweet potatoes. Carver created synthetic marble from wood shavings. He used soybeans to make plastic. Carver created paving blocks from cotton. Carver also created a color blue dye and called it Egyptian blue oxidation number 9. He could have easily added fortune to fame, but caring for neither, he found happiness and honor in being helpful to the world.
Ah, In September of 2016, Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture opened its doors. It is a place where all Americans can learn about the richness and diversity of the African American experience, what it means to their lives, and how it helped us shape this nation. Here we have the award-winning architectural team, lead designer David Ajay, and lead architect Philip Freelon. It is a place where children never have to look around asking, "Where am I?" I too was that child who searched the world and asked, "Where am I?" These images are from my books, the books that my mother lovingly read to me. I was beside myself with joy to rush to the National Museum of African American History and Culture to see my great-grandfather, Daniel Hendricks, representing Masons, and two of his daughters. One, my paternal grandmother, Magdalene Hendricks Bouzet, and her older sister, representing Eastern Stars. Here I am showing off. Those are my peeps. So I say to you, my dear children, dream like Martin, lead like Harriet, fight like Malcolm, write like Maya, think like Garvey, rebel like Rosa, educate like Du Bois, inspire like Obama, and now forge ahead just like Kamala. Yes, my precious children, a change is gonna come, because you matter. Black lives matter. Black children matter too.